chapter 3, verses 31 to 40.
ते मतमिकं नित्यम् अनुतिष्ठन्ति मानवाः श्रद्धावन्तो न शूयन्तः उच्यन्ते चेति कर्मभिः एते तदभ्यशूयन्तः नानुतिष्ठन्ति मे मतम् सर्वज्ञानविमूढांस्तान् ಿಷ್ಯಾಗದ್ವೇಷವ್ಯವಸ್ಥಿತೌ ತಯೋರ್ನ ವಶಮಾಗಚ್ಛೇತ್ ಸೌಖ್ಯಸ್ಯ ಪರಿಪಂಥಿನೌ ಶ್ರೇಯಾನ್ ಸ್ವಧರ್ಮೋ ವಿಗುಣಃ ಪರಧರ್ಮಾ ಸ್ವನುಷ್ಠಿತಾ ಸ್ವಧರ್ಮೇ ನಿಧನಂ ಶ್ರೇಯಃ ಪರಧರ್ಮೋ ಭಯಾವಹಃ ಅರ್ಜುನ ಉವಾಚ ಅಥ ಕೇನ ಪ್ರಯುಕ್ತೋಯಂ पापं चरति पुरुषः अनिच्छन्नपि वाष्णेय फलादिमनियोजितः श्रीभगवानुवाच कामयेश क्रोधयेशः रजोगुणसमुद्भवः महाशनो महापाप्मा पित्रेण मिह वैरिणम् भूते नाव्रियते वह्निः यतादर्शो मलेन च यतो देनावृतो गर्भः तथा तेनेदमावृतम् आवृतम् ज्ञानमेतेन ज्ञानिनो नित्यवैरिणा कामरूपेण कौन्तेय दुष्पूरेणामलेन च इन्द्रियाणि मनो बुद्धिः अस्याधिष्ठानमुच्यते एतैर्विमोहयत्येषः ज्ञानमावृत्य देहिनम्
Know them to be ruined. Those who carp at this teaching of mine and do not practice it, deluded in all knowledge and senseless. Throughout the Shastras, they keep talking about delusion because delusion is paradoxical in nature. If it is not a paradox, then you can't get deluded. You get deluded only because it's a paradox. If what you see is what it is, then there is no delusion. What you see is not what it is. Deluded in all knowledge. This is the very meaning of the word delusion. It is paradoxical. Paradoxical in the sense, what you see is not what it is. All knowledges, because in the terrestrial world everybody has some knowledge or the other. A person might have the knowledge of carpentry, another person the knowledge of cooking, another person the knowledge of engineering, medicine, another person has a skill of not doing anything also. So everybody has a knowledge of something or the other. The fundamental root of all knowledge is ignorance. That's why it is paradoxical. The fundamental root of all knowledge is ignorance. You may not agree with it. It may be very confusing or it may sound paradoxical. You may not agree with it. That's why he says, deluded in all knowledge. Meaning, everybody has some knowledge or the other, but the root of all knowledge is ignorance. Because, number one, a particular knowledge makes you to believe you know something. Whereas, in reality, you do not know. Because, what you do not know, what you are supposed to do with that knowledge also you don't know. You have a knowledge, and what you are supposed to do with that knowledge, you don't know. You don't know means you are supposed to use that knowledge and eliminate your desires and get back to the self. You don't know that. Using that knowledge, what do you do? What does a human being do? Gathers more and more desires. In that sense, that even the knowledge that you have, you really, even if you say you have a knowledge, truly speaking, you don't know. Deeper than that is the very mystery of life itself. The very paradox of life, the very mystery of life. We say the very mystery of life. Generations have lived not knowing why they are living for. They also died, not knowing why they died, where are they going to go. And we are also living not knowing why we are leaving. Even if you leave, where you are, every facet of life is ignorance. And this ignorance, instead of appearing as ignorance and driving you to seek the answer, it makes you to believe you know something. That is why it is called delusion. Deluded in all knowledges. If you say an ignorant man is deluded man, it is okay. But you don't say a knowledgeable person as deluded. But here he says deluded in all knowledge. What is the knowledge? The ignorance of the very source of life, the very root of life is ignorance. Avidya. Why we say it is avidya is because the entire thing came about only because of the reason that you do not know who you are. If you have known who you are, this entire thing is never going to come out or exist. The very fact that it is existing, the very fact it all is there, is because at the root, what it is, the root of life is not knowledge. The root of life is ignorance. This ignorance appears as knowledge. That is why even the most ignorant man also believes he knows something. Okay, I may not know something else, or I may not know the shastras, but you can't say I don't know. He says, if you carp at this teaching of mine and do not practice it, you have no knowledge. Let the university say what they want to say. They may give you a PhD degree and say you are very knowledgeable. Let the Nobel Prize people decide that you are so knowledgeable. But I say you are. Again, he say, deluded in all knowledge. Know them to be ruined. Know them to be ruined is not a curse. Know them to be ruined is simply stating a fact. If you don't do this, this is what will happen. An explanation of cause and effect. It's not a curse. Since you have sown this as the cause, this is what you are going to reap as an effect. It's not a curse. A simple statement of cause and effect. What is it? You will be ruined. Minus this knowledge, all other knowledges makes you deluded. Even if you don't have any other knowledge, and if you have this knowledge, you are saved. That's why in the olden days, in the Gurukulas, the first thing that was taught is this knowledge. And people think everybody comes out of the Gurukula as a sannyasi, no? The next thing that you are forced to do is to get married. You know, it's not that from the Gurukula straight you become a sannyasi. But the knowledge is given. What is the knowledge? You have a skill, you have a knowledge. What are you using that knowledge for? You can use it for your own purposes, selfish purposes, or you can use it for unselfish purposes, which is again part of the world, which is again part of the selfishness only, or you can use it for liberation, moksha. I consider them knowledgeable if they use it for liberation. If it is not used for liberation, know them to be ruined. They will be ruined. This technique of knowledge is taught so early, without getting into the illusory aspect of the world, the temporary aspect of the world. Why do we call this knowledge as the technique of living, the knowledge of life and living? Minus this knowledge, you will be ruined. For a few facts of life, you need this knowledge. Number one, the first difficulty in life that a human being faces, which no other species faces, is the choice. Only a human being has an ethical dilemma of choosing the food. Non-vegetarian, vegetarian, and then vegetarian-lien, vegan, different. அதுக்கு நடுப்புற இன்னொன்னு ஒன்று இருக்குது. Vegetarians but eat egg. They are called vegetarian. நல்லாமல் இருக்குது. Why this so much of variety? Because only a human being has an ethical dilemma of even choosing the food. Other species don't have this dilemma. When the tiger is eating, it is not non-violent. when the cows are eating, they are not being very compassionate. They have no joys. I am saying right from the most basic thing of life, the food, the human beings as a dilemma. Other species don't need this knowledge because they don't have this moral or ethical dilemma of having to choose the food. No. If pain is the reason for turning into vegetarian, pain is the same reason for turning into a vegan also. Other species don't have this dilemma. Are you able to understand the difference? The first problem in life, it starts from the grossest, the food. As soon as you are born, the first thing that enters you is the food. Before you die, the last thing that comes out is, you know that, no? The last meal they ate, they throw out, they vomit and then they die. So first thing that comes in is food, the last thing that goes out is the food, and dilemma in relation to, it starts from there, and it develops into, and it branches off into every aspect of life. You follow? The choice. On what basis you make the choice. That's why it's called the knowledge of life and living. The second point. The first thing is the freedom of choice. The second thing is no species wants to get into an action or avoid action. Human being alone has the problem of action, the stress of action. That's what Karma Yoga is talking about. First thing is about the, when we say the knowledge of life and living, the entire knowledge keeps continuously revolving around these four facts only. Number one, the choice. Number two, the action, the technique of action. For again, there are three things that a human being is faced: to be selfish, or to be unselfish, or to be selfless. The stress of action. One is the choice over everything. Second thing is the stress of action. When you say the stress of action, understand it like this. It becomes simple. Action is the insignia of life. Inaction is death. And in every human being, there is an attitude to avoid action. So when you are avoiding action, when you want to avoid an action, you are asking for death. It's not about avoiding the action, it's about asking for death. And disease will, and death will not come directly, no. Death has a few preparations. And those are the painful preparations. That is why they say, don't get into this inaction at all. Don't get into this inaction at all. For it is not death, and this death doesn't come directly. Death, clear. Sapar abde vandrathu, there is a lot of preparations, no. What is the preparation for death? Vyadi. Disease is the preparation for death. And how do you avoid the disease? Being in action. You avoid the disease by being in action. Therefore, you are not going to avoid death. But what you are going to avoid? The the pain that comes with the disease. The second thing, technique of life. The first thing is what? A joy. இந்த நாலு கத்து வச்சுட்டேனாக்கா எங்க போனாலும் யூ கேன் கிவ் அ லெக்சர் அண்ட் பீப்புள் வில் திங்க் இதெல்லாம் ட்ரேட் சீக்ரெட் இதெல்லாம் யூ கேன் டூ தட் செகண்ட் திங் இஸ் அபவுட் தி ஆக்ஷன் த ஸ்ட்ரெஸ் ஆஃப் ஆக்ஷன் த தேர்ட் திங் இஸ் ரிலேஷன்ஷிப் கம்யூனிகேஷன் ஒன்லி அ ஹியூமன் பீங் ஹேஸ் திஸ் ப்ராப்ளம் அகெய்ன் You want to say something, you end up saying something else, and the other person receives it as totally different to what you are saying. You know, no other species will turn back and ask, "Excuse me, what did you say?" You know that? It will not ask. Simple experiment you try. You know ants, no? Nowadays, at least for this 1 or 2 months, you will see lot of ants constantly moving. And every time two ants cross, they kiss each other. They touch each other. They are not kissing, they are not touching. They are. That is the way they communicate. I have seen it many times. You sit there and keep watching them. Not a single ant will stop and turn to the other ant and ask, "Touch me again." Can you say that again? They don't have this problem. Human being alone, those who carp at this teaching of mine, do not practice it, deluded in all knowledge, senses, know them to be ruined in Akukura, we still don't. You follow? The third problem of life is the relationship and the communication. Other species don't have this problem of either relationship or communication. They know when to get into a relationship and they know when to get out also. We will know only one thing. What? Like Abhimanyu Madhuri. We know only how to get into it. We never know how to get out of it. We never know how to get out of it. You can neither avoid getting into a relationship, for wherever you go, you have to interact with the environment. You have to interact with the environment. And this interaction with the environment is what is known as relationship. That's all relationship. Wherever you go, you have to interact with the environment around you. This interaction is what is known as relationship. So you will have an environment and you will have relationship. The third dilemma, the third thing about life is relationship and communication. Why only human being needs this knowledge in Ratake? He is saying that. The third thing. First thing about him, choice. Freedom or choice. Second, action. The stress of action. The stress of action. Who gets into the stress of action? The one who is qualified is the one who gets into the stress of action. See, it's very interesting. You have to go and give a motivational talk to whom? You have to give a motivational talk to the one who is logically speaking, to whom you should give. The person who doesn't know anything, the person who is not qualified, to him you give a motivational talk is understandable. The fellow worked for, the fellow educated himself for 20-25 years and then having another experience of another 15-20 years, and to him you have to give a... Yeah, all these are... That's why motivational talks, I get very scared. Because I think, to whom are you going to give this motivational talk? To the fellow who already has an expertise. but still something is blocking him from, something is blocking. And how much ever motivational talk you give, third day, third day back to square one. And then they have to find another new motivational person. Yeah. Same fellow, Adutha Vaati Vanda, there is no motivation. The third thing is, relationship and communication. We don't know. We have a problem with both. The thought, the word and the deed don't align. The thought is something, the word is something, action communicates something else. Like he says, one may smile and smile and smile and yet be a villain. The thought, the word and the deed can be so. That's why you need that penetrating capacity to see. Communication means you have to communicate. Second aspect of communication is you have to receive it also, no, rightly. Other species don't have this problem. That's why I said, when two ants, constantly they kept touching with each other, not a single ant till this moment have turned back to another ant and said, you touched me again, I didn't quite get what you said. The elephants move in herds. They move in herds. Sometimes one or two animals stray away. They move away. They get lost. How to bring them back to the herd? We have to bring them back, no? So there is every species has their own way of bringing the herd back. Now you can't shout, no? Here in the exhibition, police post, you can go and give a complaint there, you can go on the microphone and say, this child is lost. Now how does they do that? So interesting these things are in life. You can't shout, no, they can shout, but how far it will reach in the wilderness, in the dense forest, you shout, how long it will reach, how far it will reach? Maybe a few hundred meters. Even if you do it on the top of the... Now, how to bring it back? They have a method. Elephants have a very beautiful method. The head of the herd will stamp the ground. Stamp the ground like this. Stamp the ground like this. The vibrations goes for 6 miles, 360 degrees. 6 miles it goes. The elephant of the herd will pick it up and it will start walking in that direction. And it will not keep stamping along. Ore stamp dhaan. Not an animal can say, innor vaati stamp pannunga. So I don't want to get caught in that Pakistan herd. They don't have that relationship, that communication, they don't have that issue. Human being alone needs this knowledge of life and living because they only have this difficulty. After 50 years of marriage also, the husband is not understanding what I am saying, the wife is not understanding, no? Communication, relationship. The fourth wonderful part is this. We do not know how to grow out of contentment. All our growth stems from a deep sense of discontentment. When we say this knowledge is taught in the Gurukulas and everybody has come out equipped with this knowledge of life and living, at least when somebody asks you, you should be able to memorize and repeat this. Now memorize pani repeat pandra. So you also do that. Four things. You follow? What did they learn so that when they came out, they knew how to live life? Four facets. the freedom of choice, the stress of action, relationship, communication. Fourth one is how to grow out of contentment. We get into a relationship wanting harmony. Paradoxically, we do something that takes the harmony away. You follow? We all get into a relationship, or we all want a harmonious relationship. But we do something, but we can't avoid relationship. But we do something that takes the harmony away from that relationship. So this knowledge says, anyway, you have to get into a relationship, might as well know how to relate. And all relationship knowledge boils down to one word. What is that one word, if you have heard me before? Are you what is it? All relationship boils down to one word only. What is that one word? Just one word. Mind, eh? Mind, objectivity, detachment. You know this one word, you have learnt relationship. Ellathum oru oru word. If you know this one word, you have learnt relationship. And don't worry, and oru vaartha varadhu konjam kashtam da. Not impossible, but difficult. Just one word. Napa? Acceptance. Flavor. இது போன வாரமோ முந்தின வாரமோ அது ஒன் வேர்ட் எல்லாம் அந்த ஒரு வார்த்தையை சொன்னா போர் அடிக்குமே. வி கீப் கிவிங் ஸ்டோரிஸ் ஆஃப்டர் ஸ்டோரிஸ் எவ்ரி வீக், அவ்வளவுதான். பட் இட் பாயில்ஸ் டவுன் டு ஒன்லி ஜஸ்ட் ஒன் வேர்ட். தி என்டையர் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங், தி என்டையர் நாலேஜ் ஆஃப் ரிலேஷன்ஷிப் பாயில்ஸ் டவுன் டு ஒன் வேர்ட். அண்ட் தட் ஒன் வேர்ட் இஸ் எக்ஸ்பெக்டேஷன்ஸ். But how to have a relationship? Okay, so romba over expectations la vechikudadu, but limited expectation. Yeah. And without expectation, how can you live? Therefore have minimum expectation. Whatever your minimum is torturous and maximum to the other person. Relationship is, see, you will say it as very, you say it as very minimal. And the child comes back from school, will enna sir, what happened in the school nu kekkuradhu oru appa. And the child answers in one word, what? Nothing. From morning till evening nothing happened. Teachers, all teachers are leave today. I said, I also went to school, never it has happened there. All the teachers went on a holiday. No. But then you ask the children, they will say, all teachers on leave. Minimum expectation, what you call as the minimum expectation, is so maximum and torturous to the other relationship. So the entire knowledge of relationship boils down to one word. என்ன வேர்ட் பாது? எக்ஸ்பெக்டேஷன். மூணாவது பாயிண்ட், நாலாவது இதுதான். வாட் இஸ் த ஃபோர்த் ஒன்? ஹவு டு க்ரோ அவுட் ஆஃப் கண்டென்ட்மெண்ட். வி டு நாட் நோ தட் வி நீட் டு க்ரோ அவுட் ஆஃப் எ டிஸ்கண்டென்ட்மெண்ட் வித் த ப்ரெசன்ட் ஃபியூயல்ஸ் த கான்செப்ட் ஆஃப் க்ரோத். இஃப் யூ ஆர் கண்டென்டட் இன் தி ப்ரெசன்ட், இட் டசன்ட் ஃபியூயல் growth. You have to be dissatisfied with what you are today, then only you can grow. Correct? Here is the knowledge that says how to achieve growth out of contentment. You have learned how to? You have learned how to live life. You have learned the knowledge of life and living. What is Vedanta? The knowledge of life and living. You know that. That's what he says. In India, it was taught in the past in Gurukulas from the age of 8 or 10. And when they came out, they knew how to live. And we think they were taught chanting, they were taught the rituals, they were taught the mantras. No, we think like that. Because for us, religion means only that. That is why even today when we say gain this knowledge, now we are so scared to learn this, because we think this knowledge means it is chanting. Adala Venkat vera chant pannaarna iyo adu enna chant pannaar avarku therinjaach okay illaya adha namukku puriyadho illayo chanting rituals. And why this knowledge was taught at the age of 8 and 10, why everybody went to learn this knowledge at 8 and 10 is still intriguing today also. How much ever you hear, you will be very confused as to what they were taught. These are the things they were taught. A few, when I say a few, very handful, who picked up this, the true meaning of this knowledge, aspired for moksha, and they got liberated, and thus there was this chain of unbroken lineage, unbroken succession of enlightened masters. This, now in the absence of this knowledge, it is very difficult. The absence of this knowledge, you have to learn it by yourself. Not only you have to learn it by yourself, you have to fight the environment in order to learn this. Therefore you see, people are getting ruined. What is the ruination? Relatively, it is mental agitation. Absolutely, it is bondage. Ruined means, know them to be ruined, means two things. Relatively, you will be mentally agitated. Irrespective of what you have or what you don't have, you will be agitated. Irrespective of what is there or what is not there, you live in agitations. In the relative sense, in the absolute sense, it is bondage. Krishna is actually concerned about the absolute sense, not so much in the relative sense, because in the relative sense, all the peace and thing that you experience has a temporary light, for you will get back into another cycle of misery and agitations. Therefore, when he says, know them to be ruined in the absolute sense. What is the absolute sense? The bondage. What is the bondage? The bondage of the human being is the desires. Bondage is likes and dislikes, desires. That's why he is going to say, four times he is going to say, how these likes and dislikes are the enemies, are so dangerous to you, that's causing your bondage. Four times he is going to repeat. Vairinam, nitya vairinam, shatru, paripantinav. The four different words saying how these likes and dislikes are the cause for your ruination. And what is the ruination? Bondage. You learn this knowledge, Arjuna, but whoever practices this attains moksha, but those who carp at this teaching of mine and do not practice it, know them to be ruined. and how they live their life, deluded in all knowledge and senseless. That I already explained. Deluded in all knowledge means, howsoever wise you are, the root of your knowledge is ignorance. The root of the knowledge is ignorance. Paradoxical. And what is the ignorance? What is the manifestation of ignorance? That's where it is difficult. That's where it is delusive. The root of all knowledge is ignorance. And how does ignorance express itself? How does ignorance manifest itself? Ignorance expresses itself. Ignorance manifests itself as I know. If it manifests itself as I don't know, then it is not. Then it is no more a paradox. But it expresses itself as I know. That's what Josh Billing says. The trouble with people is their
knowing,
he said. The trouble with people is their knowing. They know which they actually do not know. Conversely, what you are capable of knowing, you don't make an attempt. You are capable of knowing only one thing. What? Your true nature, your true self. And the person doesn't make an effort to know that, but he makes an effort to know something else, which is fundamentally ignorant by nature, but he believes he knows. Deluded in all knowledge and senseless, know them to be ruined. You never get a harsh statement like this from a master. Very rarely you get statements like this. For all along, he is so compassionate, he is so understanding, he is so cooperative, he goes with you all the time. But once in a while he has to say the truth also. In chapter 2 he said, "You speak like a wise man, Arjuna." That itself would have affected him so much, he didn't say anything after that. Now he is saying, know them to be ruined. And then you will immediately find, from the next verses, you will see how he tones it down so much, so that the effect of the previous verse is lost. Ya pasyati, whoever gets it, they get it and they know. Again in 4th chapter he says something very, very harsh. Again in 7th chapter he will say something very, very harsh. And finally he give up and says, Ya pasyati. You follow? Know them to be ruined. Whoever, he is not saying, Arjuna, you will be ruined. Whoever does it, they will be ruined. So if you don't want to get ruined, don't carp at this teaching of mine. And what is carping? Said it already. Carping is belittling the knowledge. Carping is laughing at it, belittling it. How do you belittle it? How do you belittle it? All that they say alone can't be practiced, sir. We can practice it only according to what is practical to this generation. This is what is known as belittling. You go to a doctor and he gives you a medicine. You come back and say, அவர் கொடுக்கிற மருந்தெல்லாம் வேலை செய்யுமான் டவுட்டாக தான் இருக்குன்னா, யூ ஆர் belittling his knowledge and that medicine by the law will not work for you. You can go to 100 best doctors, still the medicine will not work for you. Yeah. You trust the doctor, what they call as placebo effect, you know, you trust the doctor and he gives you just a sugar, for a sugar coated thing, it works. That's what it is. But those who carp at this teaching of mine, do not practice it, means they have already heard it. They have already heard it, you have already understood it, you are already appreciating it, but not willing to take the plunge. Not willing to take the plunge to practice it. What is the willingness to take the plunge? Yes, mechanically also tell yourself, doesn't matter, it's not that you are going to get liberated nalike. Just tell yourself, what is taking the plunge means? Nothing short of liberation. Not that I am going to get liberated today itself. Not that I am going to get liberated the next week itself. That is still a long way. But what is the starting point? That's where Shraddha comes. The starting point is, you say, moksha is liberation. Moksha, self-realization, is the goal. But adinnene therile sir, how can you practice that which you do not know? Paradox of life. Only when you do it, you will know. Again, it's a paradox of life. Theoretically, I understand the importance of exercises. Will that help you? Opposite to that is, you may not know anything about, you may not know anything about all this. You start, you know. So the paradox of life is, you can never wait for understanding to start. In fact, doing is the conducive environment for understanding. Again the paradox. What is the paradox? Who understands the importance of education? The educated person. See, you know, who are the fellows who told us to work for independence? Okay. Who are the founder members of the independent movement, Congress? Who are the founder members? You know that? Don't say Jawaharlal Nehru, Rajiv Gandhi, Sonia Gandhi, Lamma. Who are the founder members? Three Englishmen. The freedom, the man who experienced the freedom, knows the value of freedom and then come and tell us, work for your freedom. We pick up from that and we start. Paradoxically speaking, logically speaking, who should do that? One who is in bondage, no. But then it doesn't work like that. One who is in bondage will continue to be in bondage only. That's why these fellows were negotiating part to freedom. That man came and said, tell these fellows to get out. For freedom is complete. There's no such thing as partial freedom. You follow? Not only that, all those who worked for freedom were educated paradoxically in London, no? Correct? Have you concept lumpurilla? At least history you can understand and correlate. You go there, you experience the freedom, you come back and so, who understands the value of freedom? The one who is free, who understands the importance of education, the one who is educated. Same law holds good for, you think, the poor man, the man on the roadside in poverty should understand the meaning of wealth, no? Paradoxically, who understands the value of wealth? The one who has wealth. That is why he will be so careful with each and every penny. Because he knows the value. See, you are there. Why is he so? He is having so much because he knew the value. See, here is a fellow on the roadside who is struggling for that 150 rupees, 200 rupees. You give him that 150, 200 rupees, he can never think of how to safeguard it, double it. He will immediately think in terms of another word, indulgence. He will immediately think of indulgence. So you give him 200 rupees, 150 rupees goes in the government. Correct. He is so charitable. He gives that 150 rupees to the government. Who understands? Paradoxically it is. See, but then logically you always think, oh, I didn't have money, therefore I understand the value of money. You will say it. But when you get it, immediately what will be the tendency? To indulge in it. You follow? In every aspect of life, what we have understood life versus the truth of life is paradoxical. Who understands the value of time? The one who is so conscious of it. Not the one who is wasting it. Correct? Who understands the value of time? The one who is so conscious of it. So the person who is knowledgeable about something only understands the... So from this, you derive the formula. What is the formula? Freedom is understood by one who is free. That's why he keeps on saying, know them to be ruined, know them to be ruined, know them to be ruined. Because he understands the pain of bondage. Know them to be ruined. You will be ruined if you carp at this teaching of mine and do not practice it, deluded in all knowledge and senseless. Verse number
33.
Even a man of knowledge acts in accordance with his own nature. Beings follow their nature. What can restraint do? From ruination is starting to soften, pacify. Don't worry, you will not get. Explain what it is. Even a man of knowledge acts in accordance with his own nature, vasanas. Beings follow their nature. What can restraint do? Na? Restraint alone? What is he saying? The above observation seems to imply a human being is helpless. Nothing will work. Carefully follow the sequence. Previous 2-3 verses he was saying, practice it. If you don't do this, you will be ruined. If you learn, you will be liberated and all that. Rule of Ketralam kuda, nothing is happening. Don't worry. You follow your helplessly, you will be a victim of your nature. What can restraint do? The interim period between knowledge and wisdom. There is an interim period between knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge doesn't become wisdom straight away. It goes through various stages. In that interim period, even though you have knowledge, you will still be helplessly acting according to your nature, vasanas. Therefore, don't feel bad if you are carping. Don't feel bad if you are not following. Helplessly you are acting according to your nature. But don't stop doing. Don't stop doing. Prabhakar, your favorite word. Don't stop doing tapas. Don't stop doing tapas. Just because you started tapas in the morning, afternoon you will not become enlightened. You will not become a sage. There is that interim period. In that interim period, what will help you to sustain this interim period in you and when you observe the other? It's one of the extraordinary observations of life. Beings act in according to their own nature. Understand the difference. Two words you understand. One is helplessness, another is intentional. Learn these two words. One is helplessness, another is intention. All your anger and frustration and irritation and all that negative emotions comes only because you see it as the helplessness, you see it as intentional. They are not intentional. They are helpless. When you understand the helplessness, sympathy comes, affection comes. When you understand it as intentional, you want to fight, you want to punish, you want to kill. These two words changes the entire complexion of how you look at yourself and how you look at others. They are helpless. Number two, they are helpless, sir. That's why I am teaching them. But they are learning it fast. Oh no, what is that? They are not learning it fast. He says, Nigraha kim garishyati. What can restraint do? Meaning, they will be like that. That's why a man of freedom who's evolved is the one who can help another, because he understands the distinction between helplessness and intention. See, it's very simple. Same act. When you do, it is helpless. When the other does, intentional. How does that? When I do that action, I slipped. But when the other does it, intentional venumne panna carelessness intentional you attribute a you attribute something negative over that. How do you know that you have attributed something negative over that? You are agitated. You are mentally agitated. You give you bargain and negotiate and have 2000 rupees to the maid servant and expect her to clean the house like a vacuum cleaner, na? How is it possible? For she will work. Avlo vaati solli puttaan, they do the they clean. I know that lady, you know, even today that last bit light like that, they straight liner. So she wipes. Even the fellows clean the car, you see the have you seen that lay, if there is one line of, you see that your BP can, your blood pressure can rise up and you feel like breaking their head or your head. Nigraha kim darshyati, for what can restraint do? When you look at a person acting, how do you understand that? They are acting out of helplessness or they are acting out of intention? You always attribute an, if you see it as helpless, if you see it as helpless, if you see it as helpless, you see the child falling down, helpless, what will be the immediate reaction? To lend the hand to help, that is love. If you want to have love, you should understand the other as helpless, then only you can have love. If you think the other is intentional, if you think the other has motives, if you think the other has something up the sleeve all the time, now you can never have love. Remains a love, empathy, sympathy, compassion, affection, all these remains as, all these will remain as a word in the dictionary only. You follow? Beautiful observation. Almost seem to say that people are helpless, pessimistic. What is the purpose of gaining knowledge if it is not going to work? That's what people ask. Quite a few people ask. Ullo naal vandhen irukkaraangala class naala, what is the benefit? There oru benefit un therilla. Why? Then what is the purpose of gaining this knowledge? The food that you eat takes time to digest, correct? The food that you takes time to digest. There are some food that gets digested in 2 hours. There are some food that sits inside your stomach for they say some of the food stays for 72 hours. Abdinna, if you have one pizza today, it will sit inside you for 72 hours. Now what does it mean? You should not eat for? Yeah. You eat something, 4th hour, your hands and legs are shivering of hunger. The food takes, just as the food takes time to digest, the knowledge also takes time to digest. Because digestion is dependent on the assimilation. Digestion is dependent upon how much the system is alert. Then only you can assimilate it faster. Otherwise, as it entered you, it is just sitting like that. You follow? For food we can understand. That is why most have this habit, no? As soon after they finish the meal, they walk. They go for a walk. Maybe 10 minutes, 15 minutes, they go for a walk. Why? Because that aids in you gain this, you eat, and then straight you go on. Like, you follow? Okay, as far as the food is concerned, we know. What is that method for? Knowledge. Prabhat. Naba? Manana. And whenever I say manana, he gets very angry. Sir, because that I can't do. He said that I can't do. Say something. Zillapa, enga syllabus la irundha adu onnu dhaan. Out of syllabus la, I don't know how to answer. Reflection is the process by which the knowledge that you have gained turns into wisdom. Yeah, reflection has a factor of time involved in it. In the interim period, you ought not to get result-oriented, excited, punish yourself or punish the other. You ought not to feel disillusioned that there is no change in your personality, no change in your behavior even after acquiring knowledge. You ought not to feel disillusioned. If you feel disillusioned, what happens? That's why you stop practicing. Like they say, you have to take the full course, no? When they give antibiotic, they say, third day you will feel alright, but you have to continue the course. Most will stop it. Why? Adansriya say, then why? Aung pharmacy factory islam profit goes from there. They sell, huh? Some story we know how to. Huh? You follow? Opposite of that is you go through that entire course. For the man knows how it can, the man who has prescribed knows how it can come back, how it can relapse. He knows that. So he protects you over that whole thing. You follow? If not, ironically, it appears pessimistic. What can restraint do, Arjuna? Nothing will happen. Bad person will continue to be a bad person only. Even after gaining knowledge and all that, you will not see any change in your personality. Especially in the gym you can see that. So funny it will be. The fellow will join the gym and starts lifting weights. Third day he will stand in front of the mirror and check for. He says, third day he will do that, no? And he will call the trainer also. Unnu? Unnu ilayen. First day you lifted the weights and for the next 3 days you can't lift even a glass of water to drink. How it will grow? He says it takes time. Abada, it takes time, huh? I will relax in that period. Till it takes time, I will relax. You should not do that. What you have to do? Keep pumping it in. Just keep pumping it in. Manana, reflection. What can restraint do? One of the most difficult statements to rightly understand. For it looks like the most helpless, pessimistic approach. Rather, this is what is supposed to give you the energy and enthusiasm. How do you understand all that? That's why I used two words. The beings act according to their own nature. Everyone acts according to their own nature. When it is said, what is implied here? What is implied here? What is understood here? When beings act according to their own nature, means helplessness is implied. Will you get angry and irritated at an helpless man? If you are getting angry at a helpless man, you are also you are insane. How can you get angry at a the drunken man is so helpless. Till that intoxication is there, he will behave like that only. You can't get angry at him at that point of time. When he is sober and when he is all right, you can try and educate him. That's a different story. At that point of time, how you deal with him? If you understand that he is helpless, you turn compassionate. You turn love. You turn loving that person. When you say love and compassion, the other becomes receptive. When you turn love and compassionate, the other turns receptive. You will turn receptive only when you understand it about your own self like that. See, now you are not receptive to your own self. Forget about being receptive to somebody else. You give a command to your own self, you can't. You can't listen to your own self, no. When you can't listen to your own self, why on earth will somebody else? Why will somebody else listen to you? You tell the mind, don't feel hungry till 2 o'clock today, till 3 o'clock today, na? Doesn't? It starts feeling? Go away. Yeah. You give a command and you are not able to listen to your own self. How do you deal with yourself? You can punish yourself. You can whip yourself. You can insult yourself. You can belittle yourself. Or you can understand it as it is helplessness. Some more effort is required to overcome that. You follow? One set turns blind to it. They don't even want to look at it. Another set see it and they start punishing themselves. They start insulting themselves. They start hurting themselves. When you are hurting yourself, helplessly you will hurt the other. When you are loving and compassionate to yourself, you will turn love and compassionate to the other. If you are irritated, you will throw the irritation on others also. No. You are irritated but smiling and loving to others. Will it ever happen? You are only putting up an act of, and that smile also takes a very few minutes to Nigraha kim karishyati. For how much ever you laugh and show restraint that you are very loving and all that, your nature will show. Where it will show? It will show in the area of where you are. The area where it matters the least, it will show up. That is why the other always says, what the other always says at your anger and your frustrations and all that. Chinna vishayam. Why are you getting so angry for this? It's not small for you. No, it is not small for you. Why? Because it is just the momentum that has been gathering. All along you are being, why the momentum is gathering inside is because you are just putting up an act of being loved one. You are just putting up an act of being loved one, kind and compassionate. While what is brewing up inside? The agitation and frustration. You follow? Nigraha kim? When you understand the helpless nature of your own self versus the other, you turn compassionate, loving, and also you understand what, it's not right to be like this, you will be ready to put in that needed effort for, I won't say extra effort, that much needed effort for your growth. When you say extra effort, na, it is implied what? That's why never use the word extra effort. Allah. Extra effort, na, you think you have already done the required effort. The whole extras are innum pannu. He turned back and said, innum starte pannala, adukulla, what are you asking extra? Allah. The required effort. What is required depends on person to person. So many other factors are involved. But one thing is in common. What? The helplessness. See, what is the helplessness? Say, and consider the example. When you see the maid leaving the dirt behind, she is not leaving it intentionally. What is she doing? She is in a hurry, eh? What is happening in her? She is not at peace. She doesn't know to do it any better. Idu podum. Correct. She is so helpless that she just didn't see it. You saw it, you are getting. But you believe that I saw it, no, therefore she also would have seen it but neglected it. That is intentional. If you understand it as helpless, you will call her and say with compassion, avula paathama idhum irukudhu enna pandrathu un kannukum en kannukum power difference irukudhu. You also do it, na, there is the, you follow? What you see, if the others don't see, you attribute, and this is what is known as intention. That's why I'm giving this example. You tell her, are adu varaikum pone next tile, how can you not see that next tile? You can't understand that, but you can understand it when that's there helplessness. Now that you are seeing it, you have double responsibility. What is the responsibility that you are seeing it? You have two responsibilities. That's why better don't see it. If you see it, you have two responsibilities. What are the two responsibilities? You should not get agitated. You should not get agitated. You should be loving and kind and compassionate, and yet act. It is such a tough, the corrective action. You have to take the correct. I'm loving and compassionate. It's okay, paravala, uttu pon, I can't say that. I still have to take the corrective action. When I take the corrective action, what is the right environment? Compassion. Love. And where does love and compassion come from? First you have to communicate to the other that what? I have understood your helplessness. and you are not going to be belittled or punished for that. How to communicate that? Are you able to follow? That's where knowledge is required. That powerful intellect is required to do that. You see it and you have to communicate to the other. What? I have seen it and I have understood it as your helplessness, and you are not going to be insulted or punished for this helplessness of yours. Rather, I am here to help you. No, the other is receptive. But you don't do that. You immediately turn. Either you immediately turn aggressive, anger, or insulting. You follow? Nidraha kim karishyati. In the interim period, you will go through this. You will go through all this in the interim period. Arjuna, practice. Practice beautifully, he says. Practice. See, she is not. She will not say that word. Practice. Titiksha. Practice. Titiksha. Correct. Practice. Titiksha. Knowledge metamorphoses into wisdom. Sariya. Intentional is not helplessness. Intentional is deliberate. When you say, if you understand it like that, then there is no problem. Sariya. Thank you.